Professor Dave here. Let's talk about logarithms.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
As we've been learning about different mathematical operations, we've come to understand that every operation has an inverse operation. Addition has subtraction. Multiplication has division. But when it comes to exponentiation, it's not as simple as just taking a particular root, because roots are exponents. They're just fractional exponents. The square root of x squared is x because of the rules of exponents, which tell us that x to the 2 to the 1 half equals x to the 2 times 1 half, which equals x to the 1, or simply x. In actuality, the inverse operation of raising something to an exponent involves using something called a logarithm. This fact can be demonstrated if we try to find the inverse function of b to the x. If we recall how to do this, we just swap x and y and then try to solve for y. No root will allow us to do this. Even if we took the y root of both sides, we would still get the y root of x, and that won't help at all. That's where logarithms come in. To solve for y, we have to take the log base b of both sides. Log base b of x equals log base b of b to the y. To understand why this works, let's pause here and quickly define logarithms. Logarithms are different ways of expressing exponential relationships. When we say log base b of x equals y, we are saying that b to the y equals x. With logs, the base of the log raised to the power of what's on the other side of the equal sign will equal the number that the log is operating on. For example, log base 2 of 8 equals 3, because 2 to the third is 8. Log base 5 of 25 is 2, because 5 squared is 25. So going back to this, taking the log base b of both sides will solve this equation because it's as though we are saying that b to the log base b of x equals b to the y. If b to this power equals b to this power, then these two phrases must be equivalent, and therefore y equals log base b of x. This is why logarithms are the inverse functions of exponents. We have defined them to be so. The only constraint on logarithmic functions is that x must be positive, because there is no way to raise any number to some power and get a negative number. And b must be positive, but not equal to 1, because 1 raised to any exponent can only be 1. Now that we know what logarithms are, let's solve a few simple logarithmic equations. How about log base 2 of 16 equals x? What this is asking is, 2 raised to what power equals 16? The answer is 4, so x is 4. What about the log base 4 of x equals 2? What this is asking is, 4 squared equals what? The answer is 16, so x is 16. What if we have log base x of 81 equals 4? This is asking what number raised to the fourth power equals 81. The answer is 3, because we get 3, 9, 27, 81. So we should be able to solve simple logarithmic equations with a variable in any of these three positions. We should also be able to convert between exponential and logarithmic forms of functions. If we have b squared equals 9, we should be able to write this as log base b of 9 equals 2, because this is the same as this base b being raised to the second power to get this number, 9. Evaluating logs can sometimes seem a little tricky, but you just have to think critically. If you see something like log base 7 of 1 over 49, don't get tripped up. Just think, raising 7 by what power will give me 1 over 49? This must be negative 2, because 7 to the negative 2 is the same as 1 over 7 squared, which gives us 1 over 49. Let's also quickly look at some graphs of logarithmic equations. We know what 2 to the x looks like, and we learned earlier that the inverse function of 2 to the x must be log base 2 of x. We also know that to graph a function's inverse, we reflect it across the line y equals x, so that all the points swap their coordinates, and that means that log base 2 of x must look like this. Now, instead of having a domain that includes all real numbers, it is the range that includes all real numbers, because the base can be raised to any exponent. However, the domain includes only positive real numbers, because raising the base to any exponent will always produce a positive number, so this function stays to the right of the y-axis. Note that just the way 2 to the x passes through the point 0, 1, log base 2 of x passes through the point 1, 0. As we approach this vertical asymptote from the right, the function approaches negative infinity, and as we go towards positive infinity, the function goes towards positive infinity. Then from here, we can apply the transformations we already know. Adding or subtracting a number outside of the log produces a vertical shift. Adding or subtracting a number inside the log will produce a horizontal shift. A negative sign on the whole logarithmic term reflects the function across the x-axis. But if it is in here on the x itself, the function is reflected across the y-axis. And lastly, coefficients outside and inside the log produce vertical and horizontal stretches, respectively. Let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.